Good morning. I'm Rain Musni. Here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken asserts the Biden administration is committed to expanding its ties in the Asia-Pacific region. Nearly 3 million Filipinos jobless in June, with the unemployment rate remaining at 6%. And parts of Metro Manila submerged in floods after a heavy downpour overnight. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken highlights the importance of cooperation in achieving growth here in Asia. Speaking on ANC's Head Start, Blinken says the Biden administration is very much committed in expanding its engagement with the region. America's top diplomat also lauded the participation of the Philippines in the Indo-Pacific framework, which aims to develop fairer and stronger trade ties between the U.S. and Asia. Blinken was in the Philippines over the weekend as part of his Asia tour.
We're in a region that's going through extraordinary change, and it's also a region that we share. We're a Pacific country as well, and a region that has extraordinary opportunity. We have, in the Indo-Pacific, 60% of the world's population, 40% of its economic output. All of that is here, but security is vitally important to making sure that people can live free, secure lives. Economies can flourish, trade, commerce can move about freely. Mm-hmm. And what underpins that is security. And the partnership between the Philippines and the United States is vital for that. Freedom of navigation, freedom of the seas, the things like fishing that are so important to thousands, tens of thousands of livelihoods. Mm-hmm. All of this is part of the security partnership that we have.
Blinken also weighed in on China's largest ever military drills in Taiwan, which was in response to U.S. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi's brief but controversial visit to the island.
This reaction by Beijing, including launching 11 ballistic missiles, half of them landed very near Japan, in the sea near Japan, making military maneuvers, putting ships in places near the Taiwan Strait that could have impeded commerce moving through the strait. And so much commerce moves through that strait. That's critical to the global supply chain. If that's interrupted, it's going to be a problem for everyone. So I think this reaction by China is something that's very concerning to countries throughout the region and even beyond. We hope that China engages in the responsible management of what differences we do have.
Well, China's drill surrounding Taiwan draw to a close. Beijing deployed fighter jets, warships, and ballistic missiles in what analysts have described as practice for invading the island. Taiwan deployed its own jets and warships to shadow the drills and place its shore-based anti-ship missiles and surface-to-air missiles on standby. Taipei insists it will not be cowed by its neighbor. But experts have warned the maneuvers revealed an increasingly emboldened Chinese military capable of carrying out a grueling blockade of the island, as well as obstructing U.S. forces from coming to its aid. Taiwan's transport ministry, meanwhile, has lifted airspace restrictions on seven areas. Meanwhile, it's still business as usual for Filipinos in Taiwan. Although they are concerned about the rising tensions with China, they say Taiwan has systems in place to inform them if evacuation becomes necessary.
So far, okay naman po kami dito. Normal naman po yung pamumuhay namin. Still, we go to work. Yung daily activities namin, nagagawa pa rin namin. Meron pong apps ngayon na ibinigay ang Taiwan na kailangan namin i-download sa mga cellphone namin. And then kung saan pupunta, mga nasa 5,771 po na ano yon na pwede namin puntahan na shelter. Dito po sa Taipei yon, pero sa Kaohsiung or other area, wala pa po.
Manila Economic and Cultural Office Chairman Silvestre Bellu III, meanwhile, says he will be flying to Taiwan soon to meet with the Filipino community there. He adds contingency plans are in place should tensions further escalate.
Pupunta po ako doon at magsiguro magstay ako doon pinaka-menos na mga 15 to 20 days.
Kailan po kayo pupunta sa Taiwan?
16. I-meet ko sila personally pagdating ko doon.
At ano po ba yung mga, particularly yung mga pag-uusapan po ninyo, sir?
Unang-una yung kalagayan nila doon, assessment ng kanilang situation dahil yan po ang utos ng ating Pangulong Marcos na kailangan bantayan natin ang kalagayan ng ating mga OFWs.
There are an estimated 160,000 Filipinos living and working in Taiwan. In other news, Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. set to attend the United Nations General Assembly in New York next month. Philippine Ambassador to the U.S. Jose Manuel Romualdez says Marcos is slated to speak during the first day of the event.
There are many people who are very eager to listen to him. From what I'm told, we have several heads of state who have asked if they could have a meeting with President Marcos. So it's going to be something that's very important for the country. And I know that President Marcos has been preparing for this. He has already put together a sketch or an outline for his speech. We're ready to sort of like tell the world that we're here. We're going to play a major role in the global community. And more importantly, which is really part of what President Marcos has always said, the recovery from the pandemic is not going to be done by one country alone, but by the world. And that probably will be his message at the United Nations.
Philippine unemployment rate remains at 6% in June. This translates to 2.99 million unemployed Filipinos. And while the unemployment rate was unchanged from May, it is an uptick from the 2.93 million unemployed individuals during that period. As for the underemployment rate, it went down to 12.6% in June from 14.5% in May. The unemployment, or rather the employment rate, meanwhile, improved slightly. Month on month, agriculture and forestry, public administration and defense, as well as the education sector, added the most jobs in June. On the flip side, wholesale and retail trade, manufacturing and accommodation service activities lost the most jobs during that period. Tributes continue to pour in for former Philippine President Fidel V. Ramos. People from all walks of life flocked to the public viewing for Ramos's wake at the Heritage Park on Sunday. They recalled how their lives were touched by the late leader.
Galing po kami sa Pampanga. Isa po kami sa supporter ni FBR po. Kung wala yung FBR Mega Dike, baka lumubog na siguro ang San Fernando.
Galing pa po ako ng Pasig. Gusto ko lang umakita si Presidente Fidel V. Ramos. Taga nga kasi okay naman po yung pamamalakad niya ko.
Also at the wake of Ramos over the weekend, Senator Robin Padilla, who thanked Ramos for granting him a conditional pardon in the 90s. Also present were members of the progressive group, Makabayan.
Ang hindi ko makakalimutan, siya nagbigay sa akin ng pangalawang buhay dahil ako po ay nangulungan at sa kanyang pagtulong at sa kanyang pardon, ako po ay nakalaya at ngayon po nandito po ngayon. So, yun po ang hindi ko makakalimutan. My second chance.
Dahil dun sa papel niya, dun sa pagbaliktad niya, at the precise moment na crucial, ano talaga siya? Kumbaga, hero of people power. Natural na sa isang makasaysayang pangyayari, nawawala yung mga vanguards. Oh? Ibig sabihin, nawawala yung mga aktwal na naroon. Paalala din yun, nung pag yung mga pag may mga pagkamatay na ganito, yung passing of the torch.
Nagsusulat pa ako noon ng mga critical articles sa ilang mga policies niya. But magkaraan kami ng pagkakataon na lumahok sa parliamentary arena, inimbita kami the FDR. Nauna noon, nagkakasagutan kami in media Pero noon, very, very friendly siya. And since then, naging very, ano yan, very cordial.
Ina-appreciate namin yung kanyang sinseridad doon sa pagtungo sa landas ng kapayapaan at faith niya doon sa peace talks.
Ramos, the 12th president of the Philippines, passed away last July 31. He was 94. He will be honored with a state funeral with full military honors on Tuesday and will be laid to rest at the Libingan ng mga bayani. The Ramos family, overwhelmed by tributes to the former Philippine president, Ramos's daughter, Cristina Ramos Alasco, expressed their gratitude to the public.
We wholeheartedly and sincerely thank all of you for coming here to pay tribute. We are very honored with your presence. And again, unfortunately, because my father succumbed to COVID-19, we hope all of you will do take care and hopefully you will not be in the same situation. Our vision and our hope is that you carry out his legacy for a better Philippines.
In other news, some roads in Metro Manila flooded Monday morning following a continuous downpour. Some major roads in Valenzuela City, parts of G. Lazaro Street and Arcong Bato were almost flooded to the gutter or 2 to 3 inches deep at around 3 in the morning. The affected roads are now passable to all types of vehicles. In Malabon City, portions of MH Del Pilar were also flooded. Floodwaters have since subsided. In Navota City, an unidentified man died Sunday after drowning in the river near the town of San Jose. Authorities are now investigating the incident. Meanwhile, as a precaution, the Magat Dam released water. This is done to ensure the water level is safe. As of Sunday, it was just 2 meters short of its 119-meter spilling level. Residents living near or on the riverside are advised to take extra precautions. State Weather Bureau Pagasa says the continuous rains brought by the southwest monsoon are expected to last for 24 hours. Cebu City Mayor Michael Ramos says the situation there is getting better following flash floods late last week. The mayor adds relief operations continue to help affected residents all over the province.
Meron kaming DWS, meron kami. Tapos meron din kami kung nagkakasakit, meron kaming CHAM, yung hospitalization, etc. At tapos meron kami pa rin sinasabing disaster fund. Ngayon nga kami, ibigay kami sa, we are working out for a 50 million dun sa mga nangyari dun sa Abra. Kaya we are working it out na makatulong. Kasi pilosopiya namin, pagpabuti pa yung tayo ay tutulong at tutulong. Kaysa tayo ay tutulungan at saka kung tutulong tayo, siguradong tutulungan rin kami.
Meanwhile, more flooding may be on the forecast as Weather Bureau Pagasa warns the Philippines could see 2 to 3 more storms before August ends. Makati City, the Philippines' financial hub, has declared a state of climate emergency. Mayor Abby Binay, who issued the declaration on Friday, said low-lying and coastal areas in Makati and other areas are bearing the brunt of strong typhoons and rising sea levels. In a statement, the city said it is ramping up its efforts to bring down its greenhouse gas emissions with plans to use electricity, or rather electric vehicles for the city government, electric buses for public transport, and solar panels for public schools and government offices. Binay says various sectors from businesses to communities should play their part in addressing the crisis and involve ordinary citizens.
We heard the data. We understood the science. We are feeling its impact. Now is a crucial time to act, and we need to act fast. This realization, Makati City has found enough reason to declare a climate emergency in the city. And we are well aware that much still needs to be done to achieve our climate goals.
Makati is among the first localities to declare a state of climate emergency in the Philippines, which is seen as one of the top countries threatened by climate change. And we're taking a quick break. So to come, oil prices headed lower this week. That's next on The Rundown. Stay tuned. Welcome back. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. urges students to get their COVID-19 booster shots before limited face-to-face classes resume later this month. At least 15 million students are expected to return to class this coming school year.
Yung panigurong nakapag-booster shot na ang lahat, lalong-lalo na ang ating mga kabataan, para talagang handa ang pangangatawan nila sa pagbabalik eskwela. Kasalukuyan ay nasa 15.9 milyong Pilipino ang nakapag-first booster shot na. Samantala, mga 1.2 milyon mahigit ang nakapag-second booster shot. Hindi tayo magsasawang pakiusapan ang ating mga LGU na maging mas agresibo dito sa kampanyang ito.
Marcos also highlighted in his latest vlog entry how a safe resumption of in-person learning will not only benefit students, but the Philippine economy as a whole.
Ang ating in-transport sector ay muloy rin magkakaroon ng karagdagang trabaho. Kailangan rin ng mga estudyante ng mga school supplies at materyales. Isama mo na yung pagkain, kaya't ang ating retail industry ay may karagdagang influx din ng salapi. Marami rin mga magulang na mas magkakaroon ng oras makapaghanap buhay kapag nasa eskwelahan na ang kanilang mga anak. Kaya't madadagdagan ang ating workforce.
Meanwhile, the Philippines logged 4,621 COVID cases on Sunday. That's the fourth straight day. The number of new infections exceeded 4,000. Active cases stand at more than 37,000, the highest since April 1st. 18 additional deaths were also recorded. The country's positivity rate has now climbed to nearly 20%, where one in every five people tested turn out to be positive for the virus. Overseas, more than 80,000 tourists are left stranded in a resort city dubbed as China's Hawaii after authorities imposed a lockdown due to a COVID flare-up. All flights out of the tourism hotspot Sanya City have been canceled. Train ticket sales also halted. 483 COVID cases were reported there Sunday. Health officials say tourists who want to leave must test negative 5 times over 7 days. Hotels in the city have been asked to offer guests a 50% discount until the travel restrictions ease. Sanya is the latest Chinese city to go into lockdown as China continues to adhere to its zero COVID policy. Israel and Palestinian militants have agreed to a truce in Gaza after 3 days of cross-border fighting. The conflict has left at least 44 Palestinians dead, including 15 children. 300 others have been injured. 3 people in Israel were also wounded by shrapnel, while 31 others have been slightly hurt. The UN Middle East peace envoy says the situation is still very fragile. While both sides have agreed to the truce, each had warned the other that it could respond with force to any violence. In the United States, after 18 months of intense negotiations and a marathon night of debate, the Senate passes President Joe Biden's ambitious climate, tax, and health care plan. Voting 51-50, with a tie-breaking vote cast by Vice President Kamala Harris, Senate Democrats approved the $430 billion spending plan dubbed the Inflation Reduction Act. The measure includes America's biggest ever investment on climate, with a price tag of $370 billion aimed at curbing greenhouse emissions. It will also lower drug prices and raise some corporate taxes in a major victory for Biden ahead of the crucial U.S. midterm elections. The bill now heads to the House, where it's also expected to pass.
After more than a year of hard work, the Senate is making history. I am confident the Inflation Reduction Act will endure as one of the defining legislative feats of the 21st century. To Americans who've lost faith that Congress can do big things, this bill is for you. To seniors who face the indignity of rationing medications or skipping them altogether, this bill is for you. And to the tens of millions of young Americans who have spent years marching, rallying, demanding that Congress act on climate change, this bill is for you.
Biden lauds the Senate measure or passage of the measure. He says he ran for president vowing to make government work for working families, and that is what this bill aims to do. Back here at home, a big-time oil price rollback seen on Tuesday. Diesel and gasoline prices are projected to drop by up to 2 pesos and 40 centavos per liter. Kerosene may see a bigger price rollback of as much as 2 pesos and 75 centavos per liter. Global oil prices dropped last week due to growing recession fears. At one point, crude prices hit their lowest since before Russia's February invasion of Ukraine, as the market fretted over the impact of inflation on global economic growth and demand. And that's the rundown. I'm Rain Musni. We'll be back with more news at 11. Keep it here on ANC.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID.